inflammatory process in the body serves several functions. One is to draw white blood cells to an area, to tissues. You have the release of more cytokines. You initiate repair processes within the body. Also, these inflammatory substances cause release of other substances by tissues, specifically the liver. And these substances, three of these substances, will actually sequester or grab iron so that the iron is not available to the candida, because the candida needs iron in order to exist in its fungal form. So the inflammation causes release of other substances. These substances sequester iron. So whether it's candida or it's a pathogenic bacteria or virus or parasites or mold, the body releases these substances to sequester or hold the iron so it's not available for these other organisms to use to further and propagate their growth through the body. When antibiotics are used to suppress inflammation, we're suppressing a natural process within the body that the body has evolved and developed over years. The use of antibiotics in this way is us believing that we're more intelligent in the body, that this process is unnatural, and that this process needs to be controlled. We can work with inflammation, we can modify it, we can reduce it to a certain degree, but as in many cases, we need to allow it to exist. Fevers are another good example. Fevers actually are part of an viral antibacterial defense system that the body sets up. And when you suppress the fever, you suppress that system. So we can't view the results of different infections in the body as being haywire or as being misguided. It's the body's own natural defense. It's part of the body's way of healing itself. Some of the symptoms that we see with many conditions are actually indicators of the body involved in its own healing process, whether it be it's inflammation, whether it's fevers, things that we commonly attribute to as aches and pains. That's part of the body's healing process. So if we want to be wise, we want to work with the body in that process and not interfere with it. Antibiotics create candida by eliminating the competition, by eliminating bacteria which oppose the growth of candida. Antibiotics create candida by eliminating these bacteria which produce acids, which keep the acidity, the pH of the intestinal tract within an acidic range. And it's within that range that candida will maintain its yeast form. When it goes to a more alkaline pH, then you have the conversion of the yeast to the fungal form. Antibiotics also create candida by eliminating these bacteria, which secrete their own antifungals, which help to control the conversion of the yeast to the fungal form and help to keep the ecosystem, the digestive system, in balance. Antibiotics create candida through some research from the late 1940s, early 1950s. There are a few antibiotics that will directly stimulate the cell wall membrane, causing the conversion of the yeast form to the fungal form. Antibiotics will also do this by suppressing substances produced by our white blood cells of the immune system, which cause other reactions to take place in the body that prevent iron from being available to the fungus to grow on. Antibiotics, by suppressing the immune system through the suppression of the white blood cells, further allows the candida yeast to fungus conversion. 70% of our immune system is within our digestive tract. So therefore, anything that impacts the digestive system or the immune system in the digestive tract impacts the entire body. Well, the history of candida goes back to early records show that as early as 400 BC, thrush was in the literature of that time. And thrush is the oral or the mouth form of candida. It creates either a white, yellowish-white coating of the tongue. And that was in literature as early as 400 BC. Candida, as we know it and call it presently, is really considered to be more of a modern era disease, but it's something which has historically been around for hundreds of years, and thousands of years, actually. In 1923, it was identified and classified as Candida, Candida albicans. At least that classification comes from 1923. In 1928, we saw the development or the discovery of antibiotics is attributed to Alexander Fleming from 1928, although those were discovered earlier than that. Antibiotics came into use in the 1940s, towards the end of World War II, around 1944, 1945. Their widespread use started to increase around the late 1940s, and with that we saw a lot of different diseases and conditions which we had never seen before. Investigations, research from that time show that antibiotics were causing these systemic fungal infections that were causing sinus problems, that were causing candida arthritis, that were causing candida sinusitis, that were causing candida imbalances within the hormonal system and with various tissues within the body. Candida is commonly considered to be a yeast infection, and this is because candida in its original normal and beneficial form is a yeast organism. But it is the pathogenic fungal form, which is the problematic form, which creates the problems that we commonly attribute yeast infections to be causing. Some of these are localized, as I've mentioned before. We have thrush, which is the mouth or the oral form of candida. Another misconception is that yeast infections only affect women, and this is because another localized type of infection, which would be the vaginal tissue infection. But candida can exist throughout the whole body, and commonly as a pathogenic or problematic form exists systemically. We see this over and over on a daily basis, and it's primarily attributed to the use of antibiotics in our society, whether directly or indirectly through foods.